4, verse 10. So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Please rise if you are able for our response to public worship. Happy are those who walk in God's ways.
Blessed are those who observe God's commandments.
Faithful are those whose eyes are fixed on the righteousness.
Joyful are those whose hearts are filled with praise.
Come, let us love the Lord our God.
We come to worship the one who leads us in the ways of life.
Our opening hymn today will be As the Deer. The words will be on the screen.
Thank you.
message with Christy Wendell.
Places of wilderness and uninhabited salt land. Blessed the bones and trust in the Lord, whose trust is the Lord, they shall be like a tree planted by water, sending out its roots by the stream. It shall not fear when the heat comes, and at least shall sing lead in the year of the drought, and is not anxious, and it does not cease to bear fruit. And the gospel reading comes from Matthew 6:25-34. Therefore I tell you, not to worry about your life, what you will eat, or what you will drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap, nor gather into barns. And yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? And which of you, by word, can add a single hour to your span of life? And why do you worry about clothing, considering the lilies of the field, how they grow? They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon, is all in his glory, was not clothed like one of these. But if God is so clothed in the grass of the field, which is alive today and tomorrow, is thrown into the oven, will not much more clothe you to little faith. Therefore, do not worry, saying, what will I eat? What will we drink? What will we wear? For it is the Gentiles who seek all these things, and indeed your heavenly Father knows that you need all of these things. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. So do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will bring worries of its own. Today's trouble is enough for today. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Roger. When I was in seventh grade, I got my hands on a copy of a book. It was called The Late Great Planet Earth. I found it at a flea market, and I'm not even sure why I bought it, because at this point in my life, I was far from being religious. But I did love to read, and I would read anything that I could get my hands on. Well, I don't know if you're familiar with this book, but it was full of apocalyptic predictions. And there was one in particular that I honed in on. In the book, the authors predicted that the second coming of Christ would happen about one generation after the rebirth of Israel. Well, even though I couldn't Google it back then, I managed to find out that Israel once again became a nation on May 14, 1948. I also learned that biblically, a generation is usually considered to be about 40 years. So some quick math told me that the world would be coming to an end sometime in the spring of 1988. It was currently the spring of 1987. So for the next year, my 12-year-old brain worried. And worry is probably an understatement. I spent the better part of that year convinced that I, along with everyone I knew and loved, would soon be dead. I never shared this fear with anyone. I kept it to myself, but I remember lying awake at night in my bed thinking about how I would never drive a car or graduate from high school or do any of the things that kids that age look forward to when they grow up. I spent a year believing that I would never grow up, which I guess in a way turned out to be true. But I worried about this a lot. I didn't think about it much during the day when my mind was busy with other things, but when I was alone in my room in the dark, I would wonder all kinds of things. I had a Bible, but I didn't really know how to read it. But I would turn to the book of Revelation because someone told me it was about end times, and I would read it as best I could. I didn't really understand it, but I understood enough that the vivid imagery and prophecy would scare me to death. There were nights I didn't sleep at all because I was afraid of what I was certain was the coming end. Of course, 1988 would come and go. Spoiler alert, I lived. The world went on. have so many nights, sleep or lost, to those fears. Once I figured out that those fears were in vain, I learned a great lesson about the danger, the pain, and the utter futility of worry. There was a time in human history when we lived off the land, at least more than we do so today. And living closer to nature, we had to be alert at all times. We had to constantly be thinking of every contingency, everything that might go wrong. Our survival depended upon it. If you lived in the Serengeti in 400 BCE, you had better be alert. You better be vigilant. You had better worry about all the threats from nature and your enemies. You wouldn't be alive very long. So I believe that worry is wired into our DNA. And I believe God put it there so that we would learn to survive and thrive. But in today's society, we don't have to constantly look over our shoulder for tiger attacks. Though not impossible, it's extremely unlikely that Westring and Jansen are going to form a military alliance and attack Fairbury from the north and east. We don't have to be weary of predators or enemies. Our situation dictates that we can take a much more relaxed posture toward our lives, and clearly we do that. However, for many of us, that primal programming still exists. That urge to worry about all that could or might go wrong. That tendency to examine every contingency that could technically occur is still there, and for many of us, it remains at the forefront of our thoughts. It doesn't matter that time and time again we see that those worries were in vain, and that the worst of what we expected never materializes. It doesn't help that we examined and fretted over thousands of eventualities, and the one that actually happened was something entirely different. It doesn't even matter that what does happen is almost never nearly as bad as what we spend days, weeks, months, or even years worrying about. None of that matters, no. Instead, we just move on to the next thing we feel we should worry about, and the cycle begins again. And for many of us, we find ourselves in an almost constant state of worry, always fretting over something and with little relief. And I believe it is a symptom of that program. So we are constantly on alert for dangers that might happen, that could happen, vigilant about contingencies that may not even occur, and if we are being completely honest, that often and usually do not occur. And since we have no need to fear tiger attacks or military invasions, our minds focus on things like our career and our finances. Did I hit send on that email? Or did I forget? Are the quarterly sales figures going to meet expectations? Oh my, what if they don't? Am I going to get fired? Oh, if I get fired, we're going to lose our savings and our house and our cars. We'll have to move away. Our kids will have to change schools. How will I tell the kids? This to my wife, she's going to be so disappointed. This is going to be humiliating. Everyone's going to know. What if I can't find a place to live? How long does unemployment last? How much does unemployment pay? Can we live off of that until I find a new job? Well, wait, what if I can't find a new job that pays enough? We'll have to sell our things and pay our bills, and that won't cut it for long. Eventually, I'll have to declare bankruptcy. Seem reasonable when you say it out loud. But for many of us, this is reality. We overthink and overanalyze everything. We have lived out a thousand tragedies that never occurred. We have suffered personal losses that only ever happened in our minds and mourned the death of everyone we love a dozen times over. Because we are busy playing out these what-if contingencies in our brains. My friends, I've been fired from every job I've ever had hundreds of times in my mind. I've been fired more than George Jetson. None of it was real. It is illogical. But logic does not apply in the world of worry. Facts do not matter. Reality doesn't matter. All that matters is that we have convinced ourselves of what is going to happen. And it isn't productive. Though many of us who deal with this kind of thing are extremely productive people, we are productive because we work and work and work. self-induced anxiety. We think the more we get done, the less we will have to worry about. If I am uber productive, they can't fire me. If I work more hours than anyone, if I get more done than anyone, if I am more productive than anyone could ever imagine, they'll never want to get rid of me. So we get hyper-focused on being the best, on being so good that we make ourselves irreplaceable. And then, and you guessed it, we still worry. We still have that anxiety every day. We still focus on what we might have done wrong, on what could happen. And that just makes us even better at our jobs because we can literally tell you every problem that might happen before it ever does. We have thought through every contingency that could possibly occur and about a dozen that couldn't. We are proactive, not reactive, because reacting to something is our biggest fear. So we can get really good at a lot of things. But my friends, it is no way to live. I speak from experience when I tell you there is no way to be. I cannot begin to explain to you how many times in my life I have tried to overcome this. How I have tried to explain to myself that it is just silly to do this, but like I said, in some of us, it is hardwired. We are programmed to do this. And it wasn't until I began to give myself fully over to God that I learned to submit to His plan, that I trusted in God to know what was best for me and what must happen, that I was finally able to let go of some of the anxiety that I had spent my life battling. In our scripture reading today, Jesus tells us not to worry about the things we need in our life, that God knows we need them, and that God will provide. So that's it. If you're dealing with anxiety, if you're a worrier, just know that God has got this. Case closed. Problem solved. I kid. But I can also tell you that those of us who deal with this are often told just that, especially those of us who are Christians. And there is a great deal of wisdom in these words that Christ spoke. And it's not a coincidence that He made a point to say, don't worry about tomorrow. Because you see, those of us who deal with worry, we live in tomorrow. We have lived out 20,000 tomorrows that never happened. But there's a lot more to this than any cliche can capture. We cannot solve this problem by simply telling people to have more faith or give it to God. We must remember that we are human. So while we know that God has a plan for us, we so often forget it. It is also important to recognize that this kind of worrying, this constant state of anxiety, it is a nasty beast. And for some of us, it steals the joy from the best moments in our lives. It robs us of our peace. No matter what happens in our lives that is wonderful and joyous, regardless of what we might be experiencing, this part of our minds is constantly on. It never is turned off because there is no off switch. So we struggle to stop worrying, even in the most beautiful and amazing moments of life. And make no mistake, Christ is the answer. Faith, for me, has been the one thing that has helped relieve me of some of this to an extent. But it is a process. It is certainly not as easy as the cliches lead us to believe. It takes time. It takes intentionality. For me, it took turning my back from the world, facing God, acknowledging my shortcomings, acknowledging my nothingness before Him, submitting to His plan, and I mean completely submitting to His plan, and letting go of so many things that I thought were so important. This is not something that is simple, or that will happen overnight. So reminding us that God has a plan, that He is in control, that's important. But so is understanding that in order for Jesus' words to be planted into our hearts, we must focus on coming closer in our walk with God. We must be intentional about turning over everything, and I mean everything, to Him. And that is not something that can happen to be a cliche. It starts with so many things to do in prayer. We must pray to God. And I mean pray. I mean pray with the kind of emotion that we talked about last week. And we must ask God to help us submit to His will. And when I pray, because I'm so prone to forget, I will often add to that, Lord, when it seems that I am praying for my own will, always understand that it is Your will I desire. And so that constant reminder to ourselves that we must seek God's will to be a game changer. And believe me, it is a game changer. But it is also a process. At least for me it was. It took me time to really turn it over to God. To turn my entire life over and being over to God. And that process is still ongoing. Still today I worry. Not quite as much as I used to, but I worry. And it's a process of focusing on God and not the world. And if you give it to God, you've got to give it to God. You can't fake it. You can't pretend. You can't pray one way and act another. It must be real. And if you keep praying this way, if you are sincere, you may begin to feel that anxiety, that worry, so much of that trouble drifting away. Because you come to the realization that God does indeed have a plan for your life. And there is only one thing that can derail God's plan for me, and that one thing is me. For some of us, for many of us, this will bring some relief. For me, it has. And as I continue in my own walk with the Lord, I believe I will worry even less. But I find that I must consistently remind myself of the fact that God is in control. Every morning I pray, and every morning I turn my day over to Him. And even throughout the day, I need reminders that it's in His hands. Christ is the first answer and the final answer to this issue. But for some among us, this will feel impossible. The worries, the fears, the anxiety will be more than we are able to overcome. We will struggle to make this transition because we're overwhelmed by it all. And so it's important that you understand that for you, the first step might look a little different. God has called people to vocations that can help. God has placed friends and family in your life, and so for you, a conversation with someone might be the next step. You do not need to deal with this alone. God can bring you comfort, but that comfort may come through others. Others that He has placed in your life. So make that call. Talk to someone. Come talk to me. Trust me, I've been there and I know how you feel. I'm on my own journey and I'd love nothing more than to talk to you about yours. And there are also professionals who can help as well that are trained in these matters. And I know what you're thinking right now. I know because I thought the same way. You're thinking they cannot help. You're thinking I can't help. You're thinking that maybe even God cannot help. You're thinking that your problems are real, they're not imagined, and that your worries about them are reasonable. And that until your problems are resolved, your worries will remain. I hear you thinking it. But trust me when I say that those thoughts are a symptom of the very condition that we're talking about today. Your problems are not imagined. We all have problems. But not everyone is wired to worry the way we do. There is relief. There's help. And you do not need to feel this way. So please, call me. Call someone. My friends, worry is indeed a beast. It can be a monster that robs you of your peace and joy. But it is a monster that we can slay together. It is a beast that we can destroy if we continue to love each other and lift each other. If we continue to guide one another and minister to one another, together we can do this. Because together, with God's help, there is nothing we cannot do and nothing we cannot overcome. Together, because we have each other and because we have Christ, we need not have a care in this world. Amen. May the Lord cut off the tongue that makes great boasts. Those who say, with our tongues we will prevail, our lips are our own. Who is their master? Because the poor are despoiled, because the needy groan, I will now rise up, says the Lord. I will place them in the safety for which they long. The promises of the Lord are promises that are pure. Silver refined in a furnace on the ground, purified seven times. You, O Lord, will protect us. You will guard us from this generation forever. On every side the wicked prowl, as vileness is exalted among humankind. Pastor Jim McNeil will now join us for the sacrament of communion.
Celebrate communion with you. Communion is God's Valentine's gift to us, that we might have his presence with us and in us. So we have the opportunity to share the bread and the cup. So we come now as God's people.
Communion will be in here in the pews today, so we will bring them into you. Our communion hymn today will be "This Is the Feast of Victory." It is number 513.
Thank you.
us in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Jesus met with his disciples. He said to them, "This is something that will be for you, that gift." He took bread. He said, "This is my body, which is broken." Disciples saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. As often as you drink it, you do show my death until I come again in glory, resurrection." demonstration of love God has given to us is His Son. Gracious God, we thank you
for the meal we have just shared. May the peace and comfort we have found here be the force we need to go out into the world, proclaiming the love and truth of Jesus Christ to all that we need. In His name we pray. Amen.
The opportunity to recognize those who take on special gifts in the church. We ordain three types of officers: those ministers of word and sacrament, those who become ruling elders of the congregation, and those who care as deacons, providing for the needs of the congregation and reaching out to our community. So Susie, the congregation has elected responsibility, but also an opportunity to show your love for this church and for those who combine with you. And so, Susie, God has called you by the voice of this church to serve Jesus Christ in a special way. So we're going to have you that way. People can see you more than me. You know who we are and what we believe as a congregation. You understand the work for which you have been called. And so, the Book of Order of our Presbyterian Church, in its infinite wisdom, well, under God's influence, has questions to ask you. And questions that in some ways are very simple, but in also very heartfelt. First, do you trust in Lord Jesus Christ, your Savior? Acknowledge Him, Lord of all, and Head of the Church, and through Him believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? If so, please answer, I do. Do you accept the Scriptures of the Old and New Testament to be by the Holy Spirit the unique and authoritative witness to Jesus Christ in the Church Universal and God's Word to you? If so, I do. Will you be instructed by the confessions of our Church and led by them as you lead the people of God? If so, I will. Will you be a deacon in obedience to Jesus Christ under the authority of Scriptures and continually guided by our confessions? If so, I will. Will you be governed by our church's polity, and will you abide by its disciplines? Will you be a friend among your colleagues in ministry, working with them, subject to the ordering of God's word and spirit? If so, I will. And will you in your own life seek to follow the Lord Jesus Christ, love your neighbors, and work for the reconciliation of the world? If so, I will. And do you promise to further the peace, unity, and purity of the church? If so, I do. And will you seek to serve the people with energy, intelligence, imagination, and love? If so, I will. And now to you as members of the church, do you accept Susie as a deacon, chosen by God through your voice as serving in the way that Jesus has led for us? If so, please answer, we do.
We do.
And do you agree to encourage her, to respect her decisions, and to follow as she guides you, serving Jesus Christ, who alone is the head of the church? If so, please answer, we do.
We do.
Let us pray. Almighty God, in every age you have chosen servants to speak your word and lead your loyal people. We thank you for Susie and the call that you have given in her life. give her special gifts to do her special work, and fill her with the Holy Spirit, so that she may have the same mind that was in Christ Jesus and be a faithful disciple as long as she shall live. Amen. Susie is now a deacon of this congregation by the call of God. And so for this congregation, Susie, whatever you do, in word or deed, do everything in the name of Jesus Christ. And welcome to this ministry.
Thank you.
God bless you.
Please rise as you are. With the whole church, let us confess our faith. I believe in God,
the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth,
and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord,
who was conceived by the Holy Spirit,
born of the Virgin Mary,
suffered under Pontius Pilate,
was crucified,
dead, and buried. He descended into hell.
The third day he rose again from the dead.
He ascended into heaven, and stood upon the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead.
I believe in the Holy Ghost,
the Holy Catholic Church,
the communion of saints,
the forgiveness of sins,
the resurrection of the body,
and the life everlasting. Amen.
Since the Lord's Prayer, as it should be, was included in the sacrament of communion, the solemn prayers of the people today will be concluded without the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray. Lord, today we pray for those who are suffering in our community and in the world. We lift those who are victims of the recent earthquake in Turkey and Syria. We pray for those who have lost their lives, those who are injured, those who are mourning, and all of those who have been impacted by this catastrophic event. We pray for the rescuers, the workers, the doctors, the nurses, and others providing care to the victims. Please be with them, Lord. Please lay your hand upon them and bring them comfort. Bring them the loving care that can only come from you. Lord, we pray for all of those who are suffering. Please be with those who hunger or thirst, who are sick or injured, who are victims of violence, oppression, and marginalization. We lift them to you, Lord. Also, Lord, those who suffer unduly from worry and anxiety about the problems in life. Teach us to turn those problems over to you. Teach us to trust in your plan. Comfort us, Lord. Let us feel your holy presence. We pray these things in Jesus' name. which you bless us each day. We bring these gifts, which we know are just a small part of all you provide. We ask that you use them and use us in your mission of redemption of our fallen world. Please make our paths clear. Teach us to be the disciples you created us to be. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Our closing hymn today is Seek Ye First. It is number 175. Do not be led astray. And may the love of God be yours this day and forevermore.